new face of this, which is that Shane Haywood has taken over the role formerly occupied by Tom Sott. So welcome along to the committee, Shane. Yeah, glad to have you with us. And Jenny Paul is substituting for John Hale. I can give this to John, isn't it? Yeah. Okay. Insofar as John can be substituted for.
Chair, can I just ask? I'm not at all, obviously.
I haven't done the declaration of interest yet.
No, I was just going to say, well, it is Chair's job, and only his job title to change every
Okay, then. next item, which is the internal audit update for you. Thanks, Chair. This is a regular report that I present to members of the Audit Climate Committee. It contains information relating to the delivery of the internal audit service. This particular report comes from the period 1st of November through to the 31st of December 2017. And the report concentrates on identifying items of note escalated from the bi-monthly reports that require either your attention or action. Provides performance data relating to the delivery of the internal audit service. Identifies developments being taken in the delivery of the internal service. Your attention is specifically drawn to section 3.2, page 14 of the committee papers, where a number of items of note are identified. First of these items concerns the lack of action by senior managers to address control windows over children and carers' payments. It was identified in the report and has been previously discussed by this committee. What I would like to say is, since the update report was prepared for circulation amongst yourselves on the system, the item has been escalated to the strategic leadership team. Conversation has taken place with the new director of children's and a firm action has been implementation dates in relation to these outstanding actions. Following a moving on, the following request.
Sorry. You don't want to miss that. We special around children's services. So one presumes that you as a chair will get the dates, I'm sure, but at our next meeting we'll have the whole series of events as opposed to simply say, oh, well, the report address them then. So what those recommendations were and what was needed to get them sorted out.
I will have included information specific to those recommendations in the bi-monthly report. However, it is my intention certainly to bring a report back to the March committee that will identify in more detail exactly what actions have subsequently been taken to ensure that there's no occurrence of the The next item on there that I'm bringing to your attention involves a request by yourselves at the previous meeting of this committee for me to go away and to take a look at a number of high-value contract extensions that will be presented to yourselves and report by the procurements. That work has subsequently been undertaken, and the two items that were flagged up there were extended in full compliance with contract procedure rules, signed off and approved by the relevant senior officers with the relevant appropriate business cases in each instance.
Again, sorry to be a menace, Chair, on what I thought was relevant. And I think this is relatively novel. It's intended to be relatively novel. It was something I meant to raise earlier in terms of a future agenda item. Quite an urgent one, really. In terms of procurement and contracts, we've recently taken a decision, I think it was done under delegated authority, to bring the highway maintenance contract of much previous discussion into to insource it, if you will, for want of a better expression. So that's a decision, so not to procure. Would it be possible to have a bit of a case study about how that the approach that was taken, have in effect got a few pages saying, you know, the problem is successful, well, that's done, and this is the final outcome. So would it be possible at our next meeting to have a bit of a case study around the process that took place and determined to bring that back in-house?
How are you doing?
Yeah. Because it all links to procurement, doesn't it?
Any further comments on that? Thank you, Mr. Noddy.
I think that's worthwhile because when I got the first bit of paperwork on it from Mark Smith, it was about 6 or 8 pages. So I then asked for further paperwork and got perhaps about 20 pages, but was told there's a lot more work to be done with it. What I was trying to establish is that where are the savings, where are the swings and roundabouts on this, the efficiencies and the rows of the contractor versus having the key number of staff in place to monitor a new contract. I wasn't sure that, because there haven't been troops at that stage, that the sort of full risk and costings have been incurred. And now we're wondering about risk assessment reports later. That's something that we should bear in mind and perhaps get more information on.
Yeah, and just to be clear, I'm not solutioneering here. I'm sure the decision was taken, but I think it would just be respect its history and then also the importance of it to rural residents, it would just be useful to see that we can assure ourselves, not looking to change the message, but to assure ourselves that all the processes work properly for them.
Legal view.
Chair, actually it's not so much a legal view as perhaps a helpful or helpful comment in terms of a case study, because the highways is fairly unique in that it's an ongoing process. So there must be some care about the information that's put out, because it is an ongoing transformation project. And of course within that case study, one of the reasons for it coming into council control is that the ending of the previous contract has meant that we wouldn't actually have time to do a full procurement exercise, which that's 18 months to 2 years. And so the coming into council control may well only be a partial measure for a limited time to allow that process to take place. So it's something of a mishmash in terms of a pure procurement case study, because it's an ongoing project. So I'm only throwing that in as a comment, Chairman, that it isn't like other things coming before.
David, Ron, and Jeff.
I think very quickly, very shortly, my only concern is has there been a direct comparison done between the total cost of procuring it externally as against the total cost of doing the work in-house? Because that's the part that bothers me, not bothers me, but concerns me, to make sure we are going to get good value for money. I'm not in principle in favour of either process, but I'd just like to know we are getting good value for money because it's taxpayers' money that's been spent on this. So there does need to be a direct cost comparison between the cost of doing it externally and the cost that it's going to add up to doing it internally. I think that is absolutely essential.
I think David is indicating the way that on the
chair. Just to follow on from Phil's comment, I got involved in this a bit. Two things. First of all, happy to do a case of doing it. We are in a period of negotiation with the contractor, both in terms of the exit strategy and also in terms of some commercial and financial issues, which you'd expect to £5 million contract has been in place for several years. So there will be some things that we still be working through in that commercial sense, which probably, you know, the bit would have to be accepted. But happy to bring a study back. One thing I would say is it's not entirely 100% the council's choice. The other partner have choices as well in terms of
I'm not saying it's good or bad. I'm just saying we as a council are ridiculous.
Yeah, we're very happy to share more detail about it.
Thank you. And I was just trying to say, in answer to your question, this is a live project. That question isn't answered yet. So as well, so rather than a case study, it's almost a future study. So,
just remark as well that there is tubing implications and there's legalities around tubing that we don't want to be breaching, because you're breaking the law if you start breaching tubing regulations. So we have to be very careful what information we are actually bringing, whether it's exempt or not, the certain confidentiality around tubing and the negotiations that are ongoing. So where it is all, I think that we might be what information does come.
Yeah, and again, I think I've said consistently, I'm not solutionary, and I'm not saying one piece is right or what's wrong. All I'm saying is it's quite a big decision to say this contract, the size and the importance it is to local residents, we've taken a decision. It came out as a cabinet member action decision, delegation. And the decision has been made, it's coming in. So whether it's ongoing or not, I think we as the audit committee, if the history of this contract, the importance of it, I think it would make sense for us to have, if I've used case study, and that's upset people that call it something else if you like, but there needs to be a review and a degree of assurance, I think, that it wasn't done off the, you know, back of flag packets. But the how we reach this, how we are where we are, and the fact that we've been doing it, we've been following the rules properly, I think is what I'm
after.
I'm sure that's what you're saying, Phil, but I think we just need to have some assurance.
Finally, Chair, as Mr. Armstrong said, that's important to come back. It's just a warning to Council that may be briefer than you might otherwise expect, because that
decision hasn't been made for the long term. It is an interim decision, and it is a bit like doing a review of what's happened on the firing range when you're actually in the middle of the live firing exercise. So there is a certain amount of doing things
behind the lines. You've not got the target yet.
Well, I think, you know, we used to have like two of us seem to have been in the live firing exercise on this contract for some considerable time.
Okay.
Oh, very good.
Questions been answered?
Yes, thank you.
So we'll get by March then.
Information regarding those audits were recommended action.
haven't yet been implemented within the retail scales. As I said, the actual table is identified there. There's only one item on this particular report that's currently evaluated as amber. This has been discussed at a number of previous meetings. In fact, at the previous meeting of this committee, the head of HR came along and talked to us about this specific issue. We are not scheduled to undertake follow-up work until which point I'll be reporting back on that and providing you with an update in relation to whether those actions have been successful and effective. Section 3.4 on 17, page 17 of the report, identify information related to the performance of the internal service. We know that the delivery of the plan is approximately on target this time of year. I'm comfortable and confident that we work around it and not through. It should provide me with all I need to provide you with the annual assurance when it comes to the June meeting of this committee.
So that seems like all good news, isn't it?
Yes. Feedback from clients remains very good. All key actions identified on the course have been agreed. Client satisfaction levels remain good. I'm happy with the feedback again. And then finally on page 17, 3.1.
I think we're having difficulty doing the game.
The third item down on the indicator, does that mean that if we weren't satisfied, it doesn't show up on here? Or didn't we get back to you if we weren't satisfied?
I don't get back to you if they weren't satisfied, Councillor. It would show up on there because the actual outturn would be much less than the 100% that's indicated on there.
What I'm saying there,
the narrative is the percentage of returned client survey forms that indicate satisfaction. So of those returned forms, this is the percentage that indicates a satisfaction level.
So of those returned forms, 100% are satisfied.
Exactly. Yes.
So. But you know, you said people get in touch with you if they're not satisfied. So what did the non-satisfied people do who contacted you? Did they just not fill the form in?
In the past, when we have forms returned that indicate a non-satisfaction line, then relevant action will be taken. I would liaise with the manager, I would determine the nature of the issue, why there was a lack of satisfaction, and that will be reflected in the figures that are reported there. That figure 100% will drop, as it has done in the past. Relegated in the past to 90%, 10% indicating that they weren't satisfied with the level of search.
So you don't know how many non-satisfied people there were who didn't return the form?
We do, yeah. We log every single return.
Yeah, who didn't return the form?
Those that don't return. Well, we have a fairly high fairly high return rate on these. You could argue, you quite correctly, maybe those that don't return aren't satisfied.
You could have two.
No way of analysing that there's a limit to what would be realistic to do.
The point I'm making is you could have two back indicating you were satisfied, and that would have been 100%, wouldn't it?
But you could just as easily have people who are so satisfied, they look at it and say, oh, it's wrong, you're on the next
thing. I'm confused. I think, so what I'm reading is if the target that we want is 90% of the forms returned, we overachieved, you've got 100% of the forms you said, to set the satisfied.
You didn't get 100% forms returned. Of the forms that were returned, 100% were satisfied. But what I've just said is, if two forms were returned and people were satisfied, there's your 100%. But it doesn't mean to say that the other people who didn't return the forms are satisfied.
I have only very simple people for what particular might be tried.
Maybe.
Which is what the percentage return rate was following the audit.
Yes.
And I think the issue for me is not particularly whether they're satisfied or not. It's always a bit of RA, audit recommendation, RA, why we said that. But the concern for me would be how seriously are those managers taking the audits. So if it's a good sign to me that managers would take, the owners of the audit would take the responsibility to respond on how the audit was carried out. And if they're not bothering, it might be
can certainly provide you with that facilities. Perhaps if I amend the narrative within that table to reflect the percentage of all returning client service forms indicating the sales channel level, that would probably address the issue that you're alluding to. I can certainly provide you with the numbers of return forms, because we are operating at a very high return rate now. The actual satisfaction forms are included within your reports, so the actual plan of return, the client satisfaction survey forms is there.
So,
it is a high level.
On that,
for future reports,
I'll do that. What return you have?
Happy to do that, Councillor.
If it was 1%, then the 100% would be a bit meaningless, wouldn't it?
Christina, do you want your point?
Section 17, finally, 2.5, identifies some of the continuing improvements that are being made to the service. I merely include these items to provide you with information in relation to the fact that we're constantly evaluating and assessing what we're doing and how we're doing, and constantly looking for areas where we can improve what we're doing, in the hope that it provides you with some assurance that you get the value from what you're doing. Happy to take any questions on that.
It's a bit of an observation, and maybe it could be seen as being tangential, but I just wanted to thank Mark for the training that was put on for committee members. The lady who came down, she was off to Europe to do some of I thought it was really, really good training and a good use of everyone's time. I found it really beneficial. So I just wanted to. So as well as all this, Mark's also managing to get us to raise our game as well. So I just wanted to thank Mark for that.
Okay. Oh, sorry.
The first chair of the Queen's on page 28 in section 3.3, where there's a column right about improvement in actions. And in that column it states no issues, although actual completion of forms can be problematic at times.
Yes, why not?
So, is it that officers don't like filling the forms, or is it the time scale which they produce return of forms, or is it much we get to do it? I think playing on what was being doing that.
It's possibly a combination of the two. At times it can be difficult because of the conflicting demands that are placed upon many of the council's officers. You attempt to get these return, as I say, but on our occasion, it's certainly.
I think
growth can be on the ground, began to think about risk scores. So perhaps when we get the information report, where there's a particular change, perhaps it could be italicized, because it's easier to spot. Because I spent some time comparing texts and thinking, we haven't had one some bid for one public estate, for example. Because if you read the report, the previous report said we were making a bid, then this report says one public estate bid was unsuccessful. So it struck me that there were elements of new and old reports in what had actually turned up. I might be wrong in reading that. But if we are to get an update in this register report, I'd like to hear a bit more how we're about to assess the risks about the property company.
Yeah. No, Jeff signaled he wants to speak. It's not the same as him.
It's sort of. Yeah, so. Okay, so the thing for me, and Mike is aware of this, but and it links a bit to what's been said, but my concern around the way we are starting the process in terms of describing the risks. I don't think we describe in here, in this report, very well what those risks are. And my concern around that is we might not, because we haven't followed the discipline of identifying those risks, talking, you know, identifying them properly, you know, issue, cause, effect, and then going through what the various lines of mitigation are against those, so the three layers of defence and what actions are being taken to mitigate them, that we are not getting a particularly good view. What we're getting is a kind of random list of things that might go wrong, as opposed to sort of hook up risk management. And I know, Mike, your primary area of focus is around the financial risk of the insurance fund and so on. But I have, I think as everybody knows, for some time, said that I don't think this is a risk register as I would recognise it. And certainly, you know, in terms of the updates, even if they are old ones, are just a list of things as opposed to a follow-up series of actions that would be required to mitigate the risk, to reduce it down to whatever it's been reduced down to. So I think I have fundamental concerns around this, and that leads me to think I'm not particularly sure. I don't know if this has caused consternation around that, but I'm not particularly assured that we have a proper risk management strategy really right the way through the organisation, started or from senior leader level, SLT level, and going right the way through the business. That would be my information.
Angela and Ron Sigmund. Angela?
I just wanted to say that I know that this has been reported, has been developed over time, so I know that in the past we just used to have the kind of moral risk rating, we didn't have the unmanaged risk rating, and it's been set out how those scores are arrived at, because different people are at different starting points, aren't they, with risk registers? There's no Jeff, you do them. You're not in your job, I do, but people are there at different starting points with them as well. So I do like the way that it's set out at the top. I think in terms of the actual description of what the risk is, you know, when I was chatting to Mike about it before, he was saying there is that description already there, and there's a whole series of other risk registers as well that kind of feed into this one. So this is like the headline one, as I take it, isn't it, with a whole load more behind. So I do like the style of this template, but you know, that's with everything that always, you know, slight tweaks and improvements.
Sorry, I'm complicated, Andrew, but I struggle with this to be boxes. I'm trying to find where the star's sitting in the box.
Yes.
I'm flipping back and forwards cross references for more time, flipping back to the forwards than I used to type of reporting. So I'm finding they're very confusing. I think the submission helps me a lot more. But when I look and see how progress is being made or not being made, when the risk is going up or down, I spend more time flipping back to the forwards, trying to identify if I got the risk right or have I got identified things. I just sure from day one with these boxes, and I did say at the time I didn't think they were the right mechanism, maybe for something that was down the right. And I've been doing this a long time, and I struggled with this.
Okay, very good. Start
with the boxes. The last start with the boxes on Saturday night, but
it's
all going together.
Anyone else? No, okay, back to the work.
There are a number of points that you've made there. A couple of things. First of all, there is a lot more that could be brought in. There are programmable registers, there are service plans registers, there are registers. I think what I need to try and do for you is to look at what some of the other models of information that goes to the committees look like. Maybe Jensen as well. And come back to you with some options, because if what I'm presenting you with is either not doing the job or is confusing you, then it's not doing the job.
I was a bit surprised by this one, because I thought I had been told at some point earlier that there was going to be a review of the registers with the degree to share and the okay, I can't track all the names, but the guy had to do whatever it is, and transformation. That we could actually review how we manage this throughout the authority, how that we were going to see, we would see the fruits of that review in our March meeting. Now, I might have misunderstood, but certainly that is what I picked up in conversation or briefing with officers previously, that I would have might want to.
Yeah, you know, I think there are two separate things. One is about our overall approach, how we improve the framework, certainly responding to some issues that you've raised in the past. And the other is about what information you as a committee find useful. So one is about the word framework and approach and improvements that you might want to make to it. And the other is quite a specific question about, well, what information would you find useful going forward? They're linked, but they're not.
Chair, sorry to carry this on. I'm a bit disconcerted because I thought what I've been told was quite clear. So it strikes me that we as a business should have identified the key corporate risks that we have. Yeah, so as a senior leadership team, we need to know that the profession and the senior management should have a real grip on what the key risks are that are facing the business, properly laid out and described, and that we will have a series of actions against those that will align to the events and that how they are being tracked and monitored and the actions are being carried out.
Okay, I think Chair has ready to comment.
All right, okay.
Thank you, Chair. Yeah, just
to
echo Mike's point, really, you are correct. We are having a review meeting on Friday with myself, Mike, and the Director of Corporate Resources and Reform, of course, at all. As a result of that, I've got a risk background, so I can understand the report that we've got, but it's actually not in a format that I'm used to seeing, and I think based on the conversations that you've said about mitigations and risk description and scoring, that's probably
to have
anticipate perhaps the worst things that can go wrong with repair for them?
I think he was all correct, wasn't he? But
that was a good question, really. That was a comment, wasn't it? Yeah. Christine.
So I have a question on page 33. What do those numbers mean? Effectiveness of project management 12. Where did they go? That's a bit of hard work now. I've got the star one now. I'm all right with that. But this next step series here, I couldn't work that out.
It's a combination of the likelihood of that particular risk and its potential.
You should see 6 numbers in there, should you? Should we see 2 numbers? You multiply the risk by the likelihood. And that's what you've got 6 numbers in there.
Where you wade into it. There are 12 risks in there of immediate nature.